this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and I'm still here on my working vacation at a retreat center or a permaculture farm here in Costa Rica that you guys may have seen the previous episodes, and if you haven't seen it, be sure to check some of those episodes out. This place is amazing. And anyways, today we have Jennifer Smith with me, and Jennifer is another one of the presenters at this event that I'm at that has a very important message for you guys. And, you know, she enlightened me about this topic that I really, you know a little bit about, but not so much. And, you know, I consider her an expert on this and a grassroots level expert, which is more important than, an expert maybe like higher up in governments and stuff that may be spreading misinformation about this topic. So as you guys know, I encourage all you guys to plant gardens and plant trees because that's going to help the climate and help the world, overall. But what I've learned on this trip to Costa Rica is that the trees that you see behind me, the rainforest trees, actually play a bigger role in, the climate. So Jennifer, how do trees actually help improve the climate and this beautiful place called Earth?
Yeah, it's so amazing that here in Costa Rica, we receive like 3,000 centimeters of water rainfall a year. So you wonder, what is making that rainfall? Believe it or not, it's the rainforest trees. I mean, that is why they call it the rainforest, right?
Wow. I never thought of that.
Most people don't. When I was a kid, I was sort of obsessed. I've always been obsessed with the rainforest. Save the rainforest. But actually, they named it the rainforest because the trees within 10 degrees of the equator make the rain, and they drive the hydrological cycle. And we're all seeing all of these changes with droughts and floods. I'm from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. My parents' office just flooded, John. Water up to here. Wow. They're not in a floodplain.
Wow.
They said it was apocalyptic rain. Like they wanted to be on Noah's Ark. And actually, it's the trees within 10 degrees of the equator that are going to fix that hydrological cycle for all of us, no matter where you live. Doesn't have to be that you live in the equator and you actually see the tree to get its benefits. It's sending the big fat cumulus clouds through this slow process of evapotranspiration, cools the water down, shades the earth, lets the earth absorb the water, send the water down into our aquifer so we can actually drink water and we can grow all those fabulous fruits. Because if it doesn't rain, we don't have food. And it's a bigger issue than just our, fancy, awesome superfoods. It is actually about survival. And the rainforest has always been present to help us do that. But through the years, we've cut down more than like 58% of the forests covering the planet. And those are our lungs, that's what we're breathing with. For every exhale of carbon dioxide, the rainforest trees are breathing that in. And in a way, the trees in boreal, that's what they call forests up in North America, the trees down on the equator do it way faster, way better. And really, that's our message with community carbon trees, is everybody can participate in fixing the climate craziness that's going on our planet. And it's very easy.
Cool. So why are rainforest trees more important to this topic than, say, a tree I planted in my front yard? Tree's a tree's a tree, right?
Yeah, and we love them all. We need trees everywhere, period. But the rainforest trees grow bigger, faster, harder. It's kind of sexy,
And but why?
Because it's hot, 365 days
sun,
a year.
Right?
More sun, more rain.
They don't have to shut down in the wintertime,
they
right?
don't go dormant.
Yeah.
They're constantly working. Our 10-year-old tree is the size of your 20 to 25-year-old tree.
Wow.
So if carbon sequestration, carbon dioxide is captured by trees, they eat it. The bigger, faster, harder the tree gets, the more carbon it's storing. And then they also store it into the soils underneath them by dropping their leaves and their biomass. And the soils are also sequestering this carbon. So really, we've seen that we'll plant trees in an area here and we'll literally watch the clouds evaporate up from those trees. You can see it. You can see it. And that doesn't happen up in North America or South America because it's not the equator.
So Jennifer, you talked a little about the hydrologic cycle, and I want you really to expand on this concept, because this is one of the key forces that drives the climate, is what I just learned and what you just taught me. So I want you to share this with my viewers, because you guys probably didn't learn this in the books in school.
Yeah, it is amazing how trees recycle the water. I call it the hot skillet effect. So if you imagine you have a hot skillet, and what happens when water hits a hot skillet? It evaporates and it kind of disappears, right? We see it skittle off. What happens when water hits a cold skillet?
Sits there.
It sits there. And what is the glorious being on the planet that sends that water down into the dirt?
The trees.
The trees, the roots of the trees. And they slow down this evaporation project. It's called evotranspiration. So what the trees do is they shade the ground is cooler, the ground can receive the water because it's not a hot skillet anymore, and then the tree roots send some of the water down to the underground aquifers, which we're all drinking from, you know, all the water's connected, and then the rest of that water, it evaporates into the air, nice and cool, over like 70 hours. So it's a big, fat, cumulus cloud. And then there's these special currents that run around the equator, and they're called thermohaline currents. You might have heard about them. Some scientists recently are saying that they're like slowing down. That's why the jet stream is coming down into the USA, and it's been snowing in Louisiana for the last 5 years, because we're not sending enough action through
to push it the other direction.
You get it. And so while we put these big fat clouds into the air from the rainforest, because we get so much rain here, we get over 3,000 centimeters a year, whereas California might get, I don't even know, you know, 300 if they're lucky. And so we've got all this water in the cycle, and when it evaporates and makes those clouds, and these currents run and spin these clouds all around the planet, and they send the rain that we make here in Costa Rica with the rainforest trees and all around the equator up and down to the rest of the planet. And that's just the hydrological cycle. You know, they do so many things. I think we've counted the reasons we love them, and we've come up with like 42. So maybe some of you guys can try to help us with that and get to 50, you know. But there's a lot of reasons to love rainforest trees, but for me, water is number one.
Wow, so that could be a cause, because the rainforests are disappearing at alarming rates to be, you know, put in to grow feed for cattle and to, you know, grow palm oil. So, I mean, one of the ways you guys could help this is to not support the products that are causing the rainforest deforestation. I mean,
Doritos.
Yeah, stop eating them chips, man.
No Doritos.
But yeah, nonetheless,
Nutella, and on and on and on.
But nonetheless, you could start avoiding everything in the grocery store. And as much as you guys or my viewers are aware of this, unfortunately, most of the population are not watching my videos yet. So you want to be sure to share this with somebody that's, you know, concerned about these issues as well, so that they could get this knowledge as well. So aside from the whole water cycle, Jennifer, how does this impact like the carbon in the soil? Because I know carbon sequestration and offsetting carbon and all these big things having to do with carbon, like people think carbon is the answer. Is carbon the answer with, you know, the changing climate?
You know, carbon is in everything. It is a building block of everything. And so the idea is that we have balanced carbon. Mm. Right now, we're probably somewhere at 420 something parts per million. Wow. And the scientists told us that 350 was the max. Yikes. So the carbon aspect of what the trees do, because they suck in so much, because they get so hard, so big, so fast.
Hey, wait, so hard, so big, so fast. I get it.
Yeah, you know, it's good stuff. And so the equator trees can suck in way more carbon and store it long term. And even when they die, they're decomposing and putting that carbon back into the soil. We took it from the earth. Let's put it back, and put it back in the place where the tree's going to make the biggest bang for the global climate. Yeah, we want trees everywhere, but if you're really serious about sequestering carbon and storing it in a long-term way, then a biodiverse young tree is way more effective than anything else. Unfortunately, the older trees, you know, they're not sucking in as much. So we need these little baby, teenager, midlife trees to really pull it in, and they do. We can measure it, we can prove it.
Awesome. So, you know, I know a lot of people are into that, my viewers and stuff are into biochar and, like, you know, building your soil. So I know, like, adding rock dust with biochar, putting in your soil with the microbes and everything, that'll help sequester carbon and put carbon back in the ground. But, you know, is that a good answer, or just simply the fact of growing a tree in the rainforest a better answer potentially for storing more carbon?
You know, I have a little slogan. Everybody do everything. Everything. Like, really. So, yeah, biochar is awesome. But if you're not planting tropical trees, you're not doing everything. Biochar alone isn't going to fix the hydrological cycle. It's not going to make it rain. It's not going to put water in your glass. It's not going to make clouds. I mean, I personally don't like seeing the chemtrails up in the USA. Freaks me out, you know? So I want to make clouds naturally with the rainforest trees. So biochar is awesome. So many things are awesome. But trees are literally the center of this regenerative cycle, and they are the motor for the global climate. And so whether you believe in climate change or not, I don't really care. My point is, you can't argue against planting rainforest trees. You just can't. I mean, there's no downside. There are a few downsides when people take the idea and turn it into consumeristic things, like buy a hat and we'll plant 10 trees, and we're not going to pay anybody to do it. We're going to give them the tree and then make this slavery footprint to replace a carbon footprint. I mean, that's part of the problem. That's why we got where we are today. So I think that, again, everybody do everything.
Awesome. So you mentioned another real controversial word for a lot of my viewers out there. Chemtrails.
Whoa. So we said it.
Yeah, I said it. So why do you believe that they're spraying chemtrails and chemicals all over our skies?
Because we need clouds. They're trying to create the albedo effect and cool us down. But if we spent all that money on reforesting the equator 25 years ago, we'd be good today. I really believe that. I honestly believe that, John. And so I'm like, I'm dedicating my life for the last 20 something years, and even before, as I prepared myself with school and study, to literally help us regenerate the equator, because that is what's going to make the clouds, and that's what it's been necessary for chemtrails, because there aren't enough rainforest trees sending clouds up with rain.
Wow. So they're trying to do that artificially with chemtrails and blocking the sun and keeping the, you know, the water go up, like the trees just above us would do naturally. They would stop the evaporation, right?
They would slow it down, and then they literally make the cloud. They literally evotranspire the water that fell as rain back up as water vapor.
Oh,
and
slowly.
You know, slowly
not
and
like
cool,
the
not the hot skillet. Not the hot skillet. And what's so amazing is that we've always historically had 2% water vapor in our atmosphere. And our atmosphere is made of many gases. And now we have 4% water vapor. And that extra water vapor is causing all the problems. And you think, oh, well, extra water vapor, that means more rain. Yes, in some areas it deluges in such a form, like happened to my family, apocalyptic. And in other places there are droughts. So when we talk about the hydrological cycle, it's the two extremes that are messing with us.
So we need to balance it out by planting the trees, right?
Yeah, man.
Cool. So if this is, you know, maybe a good solution, or possibly is it the best solution to the changing climate? And what do you say about people that want to, like, you know, basically bring more cows in and put more cows in fields and let them poop naturally, and then that gets turned in and people are saying that sequesters the most carbon and whatnot?
I don't get that. I really don't. I mean, cow's poop has methane. That's more, has a higher carbon factor. It's more pollution oriented. It's heavier in the atmosphere than carbon dioxide is. So I'm not an expert on this whole tilling under the cow poop, but I know, I tell you, I don't know anything, but I've seen what these equator trees can do, and they will have a microcosm of a healthy climate within one farm.
Wow.
And you move a couple farms down the way that are absolutely deforested, and there's no clouds forming and there's no rain. So I do believe that trees within 10 degrees of the equator are the answer. They are one of the best tools we have, that Mother Nature has, to help us, to really help us.
Yeah, I mean, this is just nature's system we're trying to reconstruct that has been destroyed, unfortunately. So one of my goals in life is actually to move to somewhere near the equator and start planting, you know, fruit trees and, more importantly, other trees, you know, to help be part of the solution, but also provide me and my family food and shelter and all the different things that the rainforest foods, medicines that the rainforest provide.
You know, we think about the medicines that come from the rainforest right now. There's one tree right behind us, the guanabana, the soursop, which has been studied as 10,000 times more effective to disintegrate tumors than chemotherapy. The palo de arco tree also fights cancer. It's been studied at MD Anderson. You know, the products, the resins, the medicines we haven't even discovered, and they're just waylaying it down, you know? And then the poor people who are cutting it and are left with these dead soils, because the topsoil is so thin, it washes off on all these torrential rains, and then we've got this crazy equatorial sun for 4 months. It just bakes the land, and then we have the hot skillet. And then the water's jumping up and disappearing, and our rain cycle is absolutely unpredictable. So no matter where you live, you care about the rainforest. I mean, I hope you do, because you want to eat and drink water. I mean, you want your fancy fruit trees wherever you live, but if it's not raining, not much you can do. You know, California's out of water.
Right, yeah, I know a lot of you guys that are in California have had drought and like could have to really scale back or maybe even not even grow a garden because you're under watering restriction. This is because the problem is happening here from
this
the rainforest.
This is the source. Yeah, this is the source.
Wow.
The source. And you know, same in South America, Sao Paulo, Brazil, they're out of water. You know, people always thought that was an infinite resource, but now we know
it's running out everywhere in the States. It is finite. Right? Pumping it out of the ground.
Yeah.
I mean.
And if it would just be healthier rain instead of these crazy floods and then drought, balance. It's all about balance, you know?
Yeah, just think like 20, 30, 40 years ago is much more balanced than it is today.
And we could have fixed it then, and we didn't. You know, the big conservation groups just kept, I don't know what they were doing, buying land and putting it, locking it up in conservation, but forgetting about the local people who are actually the ones caretaking the forests and impoverished because their soils are dead.
So let's talk about part of the solution, since you guys might be down, like, oh my God, John, the world's screwed and all this crap.
Yeah.
Like, actually, Jennifer and her nonprofit organization actually has found a solution, and this is a solution that I encourage you guys, because in my opinion, you know, solutions are not going to come from the top down. They got to come from the grassroots up and build solid foundations and systems and models that can be duplicated all over the world. So Jennifer's created here in Costa Rica a nonprofit to do this. And if you guys are watching me from any other place in the world, especially ones that are in the, you know, near the equator, you guys want to definitely follow a model and get a program started like she has. So what have you started here, Jennifer?
Yeah, so what we do, we try to keep it pretty simple. We're working with local rural communities. We don't buy any land. We empower the farmers to fix their own land.
Wow.
We seed collect all the seeds, which creates a relationship with the mother and father trees, the grandfather trees, so they're not going to cut those trees down because they're making money off of producing the baby trees from it. And then we produce the trees in our nurseries for anywhere from a year to 3 years. Big fat root ball, nice tree, goes out into deforested cattle pastures that were deforested for cheap meat back in the 70s. And we pay people, men and women, badass women tree planters, to plant those trees. Huge biodiverse projects on their own farms. We plant anywhere from 80 to 100 species, creating, mimicking nature, what used to be there, have the family involved in the whole process. They come to the nursery, they pack the boxes with the species, they get excited, their children come, they get excited. So we're working with families now who remember their grandparents burning it down. Wow. They were subsidized to burn it down because they don't have any other options. You know, they want to buy a computer too. They want an iPhone. I mean, we're not the only ones who want that shit. So, you know, by empowering the parents, the children are seeing that. We're reaching several generations at once, and they're planting these trees on their own farms, and they get paid. They get paid a fair living wage per hour. And that's what the sponsorship money goes to pay. All these activities, the seed collection, the preparation of the tree, meeting with the family, all of the walk about the farm to figure out which sections we're gonna plant. They usually very slowly move the cows off. We've had one farmer completely get off cattle farming, and I anticipate that that's gonna keep happening because the cows are skinny here. It's hot. You know, they're tired, it's steep, the land is dead, the cows have to eat concentrado, which is full of GMO crap, and so it's not good meat. I don't eat meat, but you know, for those who do, it's an awareness that we gotta do these activities on the planet where they most are sustainable, and cows in the tropics are not sustainable. Put the cows in Texas, you know? Leave them out of the rainforest. Let's regrow what we cut down for the cows. And these families, you see the empowerment. They get self-esteem. They start lifting their chests and their hearts, and they become teachers.
Because basically you're giving them a job.
You are, and we're not giving them anything. They're working their asses off. It is hard, sweaty, dangerous, hot, prickly, wasps, snakes, hiking, walking with trees on the back. We've got video after video of people crossing rivers with trees on their backs, and I laugh and I love it. I'm like, you know, they carry us on their backs. The least we can do is carry them on ours, because we can't get the truck to where we plant. We usually have to walk this stuff in, and very rural, and these families, they get it. You know, they absolutely change. They get paid for 4 years. Four. It's about 13 trips for every tree to clean. So during the rainy season, from May to December, they get cleaned probably twice. And when I say clean, we're not out there with a sponge. No, no, no. Machetes, cleaning all the chopping around the tree while it's small so that it can grab the sunlight and get big. And by 4 years, these things are huge. And we release them to the family, and then we keep having a regular communal type interchanges, little meetings once a year, and if any farmer has questions or issues with their plantings, one of the agroforesters will go and help them with that issue. And then eventually, after the 25 years, because we're going to guarantee you one whole ton of carbon with every tree you sponsor, so if the tree dies, we replace it. And so after 25 years, and we know it's pulled in, it's one ton, then the family has no longer an obligation to keep the trees standing. They don't get to cut them all down, and they never will cut them all down again. Why? Why?
Yeah, why? What's their incentive?
They got paid. You know, when you do a good job on something, you're proud of it. You create a relationship. These people are creating a new relationship with these trees. And then their forest is producing all this food and all these products, and we're making all these value-added things so that they never are stuck without an income again. And so to fix the environmental problems, we just have to deal with the socioeconomic problems. That's why the environmental problems come, especially in the third world, and not just Costa Rica. I mean, I would even venture to say Costa Rica is barely third world in some ways with all the people running around. But where I work, it's third world, and people are desperate, and it's beautiful to see them come alive, and especially the women, you know, and lift the whole family up and regenerate their soils and have food in their backyard so they're not going to the pulperia and buying Doritos, you know? So and Coca-Colas. Instead, they're harvesting fruits and making refrescos again, something that they do remember. They're not as far away from it as we are. You know, the great forgetting of how the old ways
They've
were.
They've been Americanized.
They have, and all the forest is gone and their land is dead. So they really don't have much choice, and a lot of people are sitting on their front porches kind of with these huge farms, totally hot skillet effect. And I say, let's reforest that stuff, you know, help us.
Wow, so Jennifer's basically empowering local people that lived here to basically grow more forest to solve some of the climate issues in the world and also solve their issues. So this is like amazing. This is what should be done instead of big, massive, you know, governments or corporations or nonprofits coming in and just massively doing a similar project, because they're not going to do it exactly the same. So Jennifer, let's talk about what's really important. The trees, right? The trees themselves. Like, how many varieties of trees do you grow, and why do you grow so many, such a big diversity of trees? And we'll talk later about how, if you live in Costa Rica, you can even access some of her trees to buy from her nursery, and she has probably the biggest collection of, you know, fruit or fruit trees, nut trees, and agroforestry trees like anywhere. She's traveled all over to collect them from all over the world.
You know, we really believe and have seen that in biodiversity there's strength and there is beauty. You know, when you've got a monoculture, and a lot of these carbon offset programs are planting one kind of tree, there's no animals in there, there's no dirt regenerating, there's no food, it's just let's do it simple and cheap.
Yeah.
Well, it is more expensive and more difficult to go around and collect seeds from all different areas. However, that is part of the changing of the consciousness of the people, that section of the work. And the biodiversity is stronger, it's more resilient. If a plague hits the chocolate trees on this farm, it won't hit other trees. It won't wipe out the whole crop that this farm has. So again, diversity creates beauty and strength. And beauty is important in life. Yeah, you know, I want this plumeria flower that smells so good in my hair. You know, it wouldn't be so beautiful sitting here without the smell of this flower, without the pollinators and the bees and the butterflies and all that beautiful stuff that makes us feel so joyful. And the biodiversity creates so many different food crops that are seasonal, so that there's something to eat, not only for the humans, but for the animals too. Like, I mean, I think pumas and jaguars and anteaters and sloths and monkeys, as we say in Spanish, vale la pena. You know, it's worth the effort for these animals to also have their habitats. And it's shrinking, shrinking, shrinking. And when we plant these monocultures because people just want to make a buck, that doesn't support the wildlife either. So the wildlife is equally important. And you know, biodiversity is a chain. And when we lose one species and that chain breaks, we're really messing with something. Like I said, I don't know, but something tells me we're messing with something that we shouldn't mess around with, because these chains have meaning that we don't necessarily understand. And one little wasps that pollinates the vanilla, we're having issues with that wasp bee. There's a whole different wasp that pollinates the fig trees. So if all the fig trees are gone because they're threatened and they're really hard to make sprout, and we lose that wasp, then we don't have vanilla. All of it hooks. They're
well, we
all related.
Easily. Then you got to
yes.
hand pollinate.
Well, they hand pollinate it. Yes.
And then the vanilla prices go up dramatically.
You know, it is in our self-interest to take care of
nature
and the chain of diversity.
Wow. So how many varieties of species of different trees do you have at your nursery, and do you provide to the people here in Costa Rica?
Yeah. Any given time, we have between 80 and 110 species. We have all the 14 trees that are threatened on our coast. We work on the Pacific coast primarily, and we do, 30 or 40 different kind of fruit trees. It's always changing depending on what we got that year and what germinated. Lots of lumber trees, because we absolutely believe that growing exotic woods is also part of the solution, and it's an income later on at 25 years, and they learn to sustainably manage and harvest. So they're not going to go in. It's against our rules, but they're not going to go in and cut it all down. They planted it. They value it. And they got paid. If they don't get paid, or if it's on the owner's land, like the big conservation groups come in and buy a big piece of land and give some trees away and pay some people super low wage, those people really don't care. In fact, in many times, I've been here for almost 20 years, those people are working against the conservation group because they feel disenfranchised and totally disempowered and pissed.
Yeah,
they're pissed. Not part of it. They're not part of it. It's imperialism.
Right.
As we've done forever and ever, and I just really believe that bringing the power back to the people, not just us who have the blessings of opportunities and incomes, but bringing it to the simple salt of the earth people, they are part of our team to fix Mother Nature.
Wow, that's an amazing job you're doing here in Costa Rica, like helping so many people and empowering. So how many more rainforest trees have you planted since you've been doing this?
I can't even believe it myself, but our teams have planted about 530,000 trees.
Wow.
Over 200 different farms. I know me myself, these callus-ridden hands have planted, I think my personal count's about 44,000, somewhere in there.
Wow.
And we produce in our nurseries. We have three different nurseries. We produce around 12,000 to 40,000 trees a year. And
wow.
So we're lower when we don't have much funding. We're higher when we have more funding. And we make sure that every tree, you know, no tree gets left behind, because when they get to a certain height, they need to be planted. And so whatever's left at the end of the season, right now we're in the end of the season. That's why I'm leaving today, because I got to go work this week and I can't wait. And whatever's left at the end of the season that's too big, that won't last till next year for planting season, which starts in May, then we give those to the water asadas. So in Costa Rica, the water is managed by communities mostly, and going back to that hydrological cycle, we want to cover the water. We want to shade the water so that it's cool, including the rivers. You know, that matters too, and the rainforest trees affect the ocean. Obviously, the plankton are also sequestering carbon dioxide, but the trees are helping the plankton, because we all know that the scientists tell us, and it's true, that the ocean has heated up and the plankton are suffocating. So the trees can help cool down the water coming out of the mountains that dump into the ocean. We're 14 kilometers from the ocean, and it all dumps into an estuary in a beautiful surf break. And we're sending cool water down without erosion, no sedimentation, filled with herbicides and pesticides, which is coming off these cow farms.
Wow.
So when we get there, the first rule is no herbicides and pesticides. Everybody goes organic. And then it just spirals into so many positive effects that the trees generated. Again, they're the generator.
Wow, this is totally incredible. I'm like just blown away. I talked to her yesterday and also before I filmed this video to like kind of learn more about it. And I mean, this is just probably one of the best answers that could happen. So, I mean, Jennifer, how can people like watching from their chairs in the US or around the world, wherever they are right now, like what can they do? I mean, everybody out there could, number one, to help, you know, the changing climate, of course, you know, reduce your impact and, you know, maybe travel less, try to drive your bike and, you know, eat more plants instead of animals that cause, you know, greater, you know, changing climate and more demands on, you know, companies to grow GMO corn and beans so they could feed the crops or cows and animals so they could eat them and stop buying Doritos. But even more than all that, and planting a garden, planting trees, I mean, I think like somehow being able to contribute to grow these rainforest trees in a sustainable way so then they could actually support your nonprofit to do this, right?
Yeah, you know, that is our gear and our goal, which is every single tree and every single person makes a difference. You know, One tree, every time you get on an airplane, will suck in 1 ton of carbon. So for example, a trip from Houston to Costa Rica is about 3,800 kilometers. That equals about a ton of carbon.
So per person or per the whole plane?
Per person.
Wow, that's a lot.
It's called the aeration impact effect. There's some really noxious stuff coming out with those airplanes. And of course they're working on that, and we need all the renewables and we need all these new inventions. But we can't eat and drink solar panels. We can't breathe it. You know, we need the trees, and they need us, and they need you. And it's super easy to sponsor a tree. You know, it's $25. We do so much work over the 4 years. I mean, produce, transport, meet with the families, have kids nature days, educate, plant, go back and clean 14 times over 4 years, and then stay in touch with the families for another 20 years. I mean, if that's not worth $25, I really don't really know what is.
Yeah, and you pay the families, you know, for taking care of the trees.
They all get paid. We don't have a lot on our administration.
So let's talk there. Like, what is the administration? I know in like some of these nonprofits, like, I don't know, 40% or some crazy amount goes to administration costs and all this stuff. In your nonprofit, what's the percentage?
We're below 10%.
Wow.
And that is because we have a lot of volunteers. We don't have big marketing budgets. We depend on our tree ambassadors, people like you, to help us get the word out. Our model is designed to put the money in the hands of the people, because that is who's going to do the work. Yeah. And it's hard work. And, you know, the volunteer things that come in give people an ability to also help with their gifts. You know, maybe they want to make a video or a graphic or a song, or they have an art project and they sell their piece of art and they want to donate a small percentage of their profits, or their company wants to be carbon neutral and donate a little bit of their profits to offset their emissions. So it is very easy to collaborate with us, and our website is really kind of long, and if you've got some time you can read it all, or you can just jump straight to the sponsor page. There's a tree icon and sponsor now, and you get to send a personalized certificate. John's going to be a tree ambassador, yeah?
Yep.
So you choose his name. We do offer tax deductions. We work with Global Giving. They vet us. We have to do due diligence every year. We've got, you know, all the transparency that anyone could ask for. And we just really believe that power to the people means that this money needs to go into the hands of the people doing the super hard work, and all the rest, we can be a community and make that happen.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, it seems like we could all work together, you know, peoples from different countries and, you know, the peoples here, to make the world a better place. And that's what it's going to take. And it's going to take each one of you guys. You know, if you guys have a company and put out products, you know, great. Hey, take some of the money and put it towards this project. Hey, get tax deductions, and also make your company even a better company by supporting regrowing the rainforest. I mean, and not one of those other, you know, places that, you know, plant trees that may not be doing it in the most sustainable way. I mean, to me, this seems like a solid, well thought out way that will make a difference. You know, aside from not eating the Doritos, not buying the palm oil and all this stuff, this is even more important in my opinion, because most Americans are still gonna eat all their products that they love to have. And even, unfortunately, places around the country, people are now adopting American products that are causing further pressures on things, and the precious rainforest, you know, like this beautiful forest behind me. So Jennifer, if somebody wants to make a donation or actually buy trees from you, if they're in Costa Rica, how can they get a hold of you and your organization to do this?
We are communitycarbontrees.org, and I still receive every single email. So easy to come to our nurseries. We also do some ecotourism. You can go to our projects and meet our people and swim in beautiful waterfalls and literally hug your tree. So that is one way. And for companies or artists, musicians and such, we will allow you to use our logo. And people that are already doing it say that they know that they are selling more products. Because I think in time, people are gonna start hearing more and more about carbon footprints.
Yeah.
And so if you're on the cutting edge and you've you're giving back to a program like ours that is holistic, is also dealing with the socioeconomic, the biodiversity. We're not buying the land, and we're making sure that every single tree grows over the 25 years. Then having our logo on your product will distinguish you. Yeah. And make your product more desirable over the next guy's product. And being in the front on these things is always really cool, and being some of the first. It's also very hard, you know, it's hard to be the pioneers and open the way. But I do think that over time, we're gonna all be seeing carbon footprints and water footprints.
Yeah.
You know, that pair of jeans has like 50 gallons of water in it. So buy used jeans from the thrift store, you know, find ways to everybody do everything.
Awesome, Jennifer. So let's see, I think one of the last questions is, you know, for those of you guys that maybe live in other tropical countries around the world near the equator, you know, Jennifer makes all her information on how she's doing this open source to you guys. And that's a big part of, you know, my new paradigm for the new world and how we're going to change things, because, you know, having like your trade secrets and keeping them to yourself is like, you know, big corporations want to do. They want to keep that. But she wants to get this out to everybody, because everybody needs to change, no matter if you're in Costa Rica, you know, Mexico,
Africa, Bangladesh. We talk with groups from all over, John. My Skype doesn't stop. Their names I can't even pronounce. You know, and they've got this weird English, and we're Skyping, and they're like, we found your site. Can you send us money? I'm like, I can't send money. We don't have enough. Community Carbon Trees does not have enough yet. But I've been consulting with these people over the Skype for years, and we walk them through our process. And many countries have the money to put into this. You know, so if they copy our model and do it in this holistic community, non-buying land, biodiverse, super duper maintenance to make sure the trees grow, then, you know, that's what I want. The more that it's replicated, the more successful that we will all be in creating the world that we want and need more and more.
Wow. So yeah, I mean, I think this is probably the best answer that I've heard to climate change in a long time. And so that's why I decided to make this video for you guys. I mean, we got to close out now. She's like, I actually got to catch a boat.
Yeah.
To go eat my lunch. But hopefully you guys enjoyed this episode. And Jennifer, what's that website once again, so that people could click right now and put some money to start planting some more trees on the planet? Even if you guys don't have a garden, you guys could plant your own tree here in Costa Rica.
Yeah, it's community carbontrees.org.
Awesome.
And look for John's name as the tree ambassador. And remember, you can get a tax deduction through global giving. John has a fundraiser page under that too. And we have a Facebook, Community Carbon Trees. And I'm always putting up, you know, daily stuff. You can see our work. You're going to see how real it is if you take a little time and check us out, please. And if you know, you share us with someone and give trees for Christmas gifts, wedding gifts, birthdays, memorials for people who've passed away. Just because, give one to yourself. You know, we can all do a little something.
Wow, amazing. And I want to let you guys know that I do not get any money from any money that you donate. They get all the money. I'm just doing this and putting my name towards it. And I want to see how many of you guys contribute, because I want to be like the number one person that brings most people to, you know, their project, so I can feel good that I'm doing a good work, you know, with the videos that I put out to educate you guys.
And you know what he's gonna get? He's gonna get this little bracelet. It says Community Carbon Trees, and our women's group makes it.
Oh, awesome.
It's made of bamboo, not a tree. Oh. And then they burn the name on there, and it's got a little piece of rope that they dip in wax, so it's just very simplistic. And you know, this is our thank you. And you know, we appreciate you so much. We really need this exposure, and thank
I'm
all
glad.
Y'all.
I mean, this is a solution for not me, not her, but more importantly, the world. So anyways, if you guys—
We love trees!
We love trees. And if you guys enjoyed this episode, hey, please be sure to give this episode a thumbs up. Also be sure to share this with people that, you know, are also concerned about the changing climate, about planting trees, about reforesting, and, you know, concerned about, you know, carbon and all this kind of stuff, because I think this is the best answer that I've heard so far, actually, in my life. So also be sure to click the subscribe button so you don't miss out on any of my upcoming episodes. I have episodes coming out about every 3 to 4 days. You know, teaching you guys all aspects of gardening and how to live a lighter footprint, you know, mostly by growing your own food, because that's a big source of everything that's happening in the world. And also be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes, they're a wealth of knowledge, over 1,200 episodes strong now, all aspects to improve and enlighten your life about growing food and, you know, topics such as this that are really important and close to my heart, because we all live on this Mother Earth planet, and you know, at the rate we're going with a lot of people, maybe big corporations and things, maybe not doing the right things, we need to take a stand and do the right thing, and community trees is definitely one way to do that. So yeah, visit their website once again, link is down below. Once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing. This is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. I'm still here enjoying the beautiful Costa Rican sun here at Punta Mona. Check my past episode for